There have been a few changes since we started working on this report, one of which is a brand new crew haircut, another of which is a chipped tooth and a brand new scab on the elbow. How do all these things happen to you?
I don't know.
Did you know we're starting our report with your picture the very first thing?
Yeah.
You know why?
Why?
Because you sang your song so very well and we were so proud of you, and it was a happy song.
Thank you.
Thank you for singing it for us. We did feel it was very important to learn more about mental retardation. 130,000 Missourians alone are directly affected by it, 12 million Americans. So to learn more about it, to be able to report to you, we went some weeks ago to the St. Louis School and Hospital and asked the superintendent, Dr. Leopold Hofstetter, how does a mother first know that her child is retarded? He said frequently the indication is the slowness of holding up the little head, of walking, talking, crawling, though these are variables in each human being. He also told us this.
Are there any scientific tools which can be used to assess a child's potential?
Yes. The maturational lag, as we say, affects the mind as well as the body. And sometimes, let's say, x-rays of the bony structure reveals that the maturation processes are delayed, imperfect, or never come to completion.
We've decided to hold hands. Actually, I'm at the St. Louis State School and Hospital for the Mentally Retarded, and I've just learned that after birth, the hand bones finally form. This is why an x-ray of the hands frequently is an indicative test for mental retardation. You can look at hands and intuitively know that they just don't work properly. Other hands do. Now, this is the most sophisticated exercise as far as motor control is concerned. Many mental retardees could never begin to complete that exercise. This child does not realize this hand on this arm is an extension of herself, and this concept of self must be carefully, laboriously taught to her. Many times, unawarely, these busy hands end up in the mouth. The psychiatrist would call it oral involvement. Right now, let's look at some of the hands of the mentally retarded. As a mother, I couldn't help but speculate. How did the mothers accept the knowledge that their beloved child was mentally retarded? How did they find out? What did they do to help? So we went to various homes and asked these questions.
We adopted Ricky when he was 10 days old, and we found out that around 6 months that he was not developing as a normal child of 6 months, and on the advice of our pediatrician, that we should look into having him evaluated. Well, at the time, not realizing what evaluation is,
in the hospital.
We started looking around, and we were acquainted with the evaluation clinic at Renard's Hospital. At around 15 months old, we discovered that Ricky was mentally retarded.
Sally
was about 6 or 7 months when we began to suspect that something might be not right because she wasn't doing the things a child should do at that age. We had her tested for a thyroid deficiency, which she had, and we had hopes that that would cure the situation, but it didn't, and when she was around 2, the doctor let us know that he felt that she was retarded.
He was about 3 years old. He, of course, didn't speak, and he walked very late. He was about 22 months, teeth late.
At the age of 4 or 4 and a half, we realized Kevin should be in school. So we went to the SLARC office, and they referred us to Freedon's Chapel, where Kevin was taken as a student, and he went there for approximately a year, and his vocabulary was very poor, and he actually couldn't compose sentences or anything at the time he started school. And after a year of schooling, his vocabulary had increased tremendously, and his behavior was much better than he had been previous to going to school. And we were quite happy with his advancements during that time.
Kevin attends a different school at present. He goes to St. Mary's Special School, which is taught by the Sisters of Notre Dame. It's a very wonderful school. Because of disciplinary action, Kevin goes to boarding school there.
The children are taught to read and print, coloring, and prayers, of course, and they are, they have a special time for play, a special time for recreation, and a certain time to retire at night. The children go to bed at 7 o'clock and they arise at 6:20 in the morning. At that time they are taken to chapel and they hear Mass. After Mass it is breakfast, and then at approximately 9 o'clock they are taken to class. They resume class until approximately noontime, and of course they have time out for lunch. And in the afternoon, he has just approximately an hour and a half of studies, and then they have a rest period. Did I say something wrong, Kevin?
Yeah.
What did I say?
You didn't dust in the dormitory.
Oh, you dust in the dormitory before you go to class.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
SLARC stands for St. Louis Association for Retarded Children. And it's an organization for parents and friends of retarded. Sally goes to the nursery school at Cardinal Glennon Hospital. It's for cerebral palsy children as well as retarded. And she goes twice a week.
Elliot is going to one of the schools. The special school district has started 3 years, Litzinger School. He will go until he's 21, possibly.
I think the school is doing a real fine job, considering the fact that the special school district is only about 3 or 4 years old, and considering the fact that there's so much to be learned in this area, in other words, how to teach retarded children and handicapped children. So I think they're doing as fine a job as can be done.
We started looking into all of the different agencies, and we came up with the St. Louis Association for Retarded Children. At the time, there was nothing available for Ricky. That's when I decided to have a play camp in my backyard for retarded children. And most of the parents, it seemed that most of the children between the ages of 10 to 16 were being taken care of, but the children 3 and a half to 8 There was no service at that time, except perhaps in the wintertime, a pre-nursery school for 10 to 15 children. So that summer, we had a summer camping program for retarded children, and I got all my neighbors involved, and the association, of course, helped plan the program and staffing of it. And it turned out to be quite a program. From that program, it went on a yearly basis at the association, and they took it on as one of their services. Around 6 years old, we were fortunate enough to be able to send Ricky to the special school district. And this is where he has been attending ever since then.
Things go along for a while with anyone, but then, as I say, this energy builds up and he inflicts bodily harm. He will sometimes be sitting there watching television, and all of a sudden he will grab him by the hair and start dragging, or a well-placed kick, and it's no good for anyone unless some way is found to control this uncontrollable energy.
I'm now with the clinical director of the St. Louis State Home and Hospital, Dr. Lil Hofstetter. Ms. Hofstetter, I understand you're responsible for the creation of this room.
Yes, I am. I have designed this and two other rooms who also form geometric shapes and colors, particularly for one type of patients only, a profoundly retarded child.
Forgive me for interrupting, but I did want to point out that we are seated on a round table and that everything in the room is blue. Now, why is it blue?
I thought that the world is very complicated for a retarded child to comprehend. So we break down the various stimuli to which a normal child is exposed into elementary stimulation, like shapes and forms of one color, one shape at one time. And we found that the children do respond to this and can learn much better.
Well, now, what other rooms do you have here?
We have a red room, which emphasizes the triangular shape. And then we have a green room, which emphasizes the square shape.
So that the child immediately identifies the color and the shape.
Not immediately. It takes a great while for the children to learn. I think you probably will see later how the children learn how to draw circles on all these blackboards around us, and until they will be able to hold a ball. I think you must understand that the profoundly retarded child is at the lowest level of retardation, with an IQ of 25 or less, or not testable at all, and objects mean nothing to them. And this is one way of making an object interesting enough for them to respond, even.
Dr. Hofstetter, what do you really hope to accomplish in this room?
We accomplish a development of the child's potential to the maximum of his ability. Every child is endowed with a certain amount of potential, talent, gift, sometimes unusual talent. And if we awaken that potential and develop this to the limit, we have accomplished something. And the children go from one little success to another one and gradually become more successful and develop a concept of themselves, conscious or not, that they can do certain things, although they may have limitations. And nothing is more important than a positive concept of oneself, to be happy and to consider oneself worthwhile.
Thank you very much. It would be wonderful if we could say that each child came from a fine, loving, wise home, that they were lovable and cared for. This is not true. There are 184 known causes of mental retardation, and we're just scientifically scratching the surface. Perhaps you'd like for us to pretty things up and pretend that each child is appealing. We would be lying. Many of these children are physically malformed. Some need to be institutionalized for their own protection and for the fulfillment of the family. But these children are worthy of our compassion and concern. Let's look at their faces.
problem that most families faced, as we faced, was whether the child was to stay in the home or whether we should be looking for an institution. Being very attached to the child, as one becomes, we felt that he would progress better in the home. So we've worked with him. We've treated him not as a retarded or a special child. We've tried to treat him as a child would normally be treated. Of course, we had to make certain allowances for his capabilities, and we knew they were limited, so we had to help him in certain areas. However, we have felt, and we have been told by professional people and by evaluation, that he has progressed a great deal farther, having been in the home and in a family surrounding, than he would have been in an institution where he was just a number or one of many. Now, the neighborhood children have come to accept him, and they play with him. They always give him his turn at bat when they're playing baseball. Although he interrupts the game, they all feel and they know him, and they respect his handicap. And we've found that it's been a wonderful experience with us and our neighbors.
Retarded children thrive on love. They love to be played with, they love to be handled. They're very affectionate, and they can feel it instantly. They love to be around children, and they love to be around anyone that has passion for them. I think the most important part in their growing up and progress is having the love and affection of the parents and the grandparents that ours give Ricky, and of course our neighbors too.
It's been a problem, but now as I'm becoming more mature, I'm, I guess, realizing it, and in this certain cases it, or instances, it has helped me to become more mature, realizing the problems of mental retardation and the fact that I've got to be acceptant and try and do as much as I possibly can for Elliot.
A retarded child, they just take a lot longer to learn and to go from one stage to the next. And she does present the problem in that she's bigger than most children when they go through these different stages, and therefore she's able to get into more things and for longer periods of time. She's very happy here, and she gets a good deal of love and attention where I don't think she could get anywhere else, at least at this particular time in her life. And I believe the other children and my husband and I are, we're benefited from having her here, because she's such a happy little child. She sort of makes us happy many times.
Elliot's particularly aware of our moods. He can tell immediately when we're annoyed or angry, and he's a very devoted, has always been a very lovable kind of child. He likes situations and will stay in environments that he knows he's being accepted, and immediately walks away from the people that won't accept him. He loves being in school. He loves his extra activities he has now with the bowling. And all of the kids seem to be very much devoted to each other.
Love is such an important factor in, well, I think in any child's life, but I think maybe even more so in a retarded child, because they just can't understand as well.
Daddy.
And I think in a home situation, I think they do get a lot of love and attention.
I love Kevin. I'll never part with Kevin as long as I live.
But each parent we talked with, in different words, expressed the same fears.
We had to keep him in the yard because he didn't realize danger. We were right on a bus line, and there were times when he would get out on me, and one time he just missed being hit by a bus. Well, the children in the neighborhood realized that I didn't want him out, and if he got out, they would run him back in the yard, but it wasn't in a kind way. They would either throw a rock at him, or one day he got hit by a big branch off a tree. They hit him with it. He got hit alongside of the head and down his back, and of course he came in crying, and they run off. Well, we stayed for about 3 years, and things just got to the point where it was just unbearable as far as he was concerned. He just didn't have any life. Well, now, we've moved here recently, and we are very hopeful that he will be accepted here, and that the children here will be a little more considerate of him.
Well, Elliot's in school now, and he's getting as much education as he possibly can get. Then when he gets out of school, we hope to keep him at home, but this depends to some degree on whether the facilities in the community will be available. What he will need essentially is some sort of vocational training and then a sheltered workshop where he can do something socially useful and yet be in a non-competitive environment.
I don't feel enough. I do feel that a great deal is being done, and I'm sure as time goes on, a great deal more will be done. And it's one organization. Of course, we are obviously interested in helping further along, and we're doing we're trying to find everything we can about it. We want to help Sally as much as possible. Of course, sometimes we do get frustrated. We don't know what to do. But I will say this, compared to the people 25 years or longer ago, it's infinitely better.
The biggest problem with the retarded child is what happens when he reaches the age of 19 or 20, when he's no longer eligible for the special school district program. Presently, the only available sheltered workshop is Projects Incorporated, which is a division or an offshoot of the St. Louis Association for Retarded Children, where the children are taught a particular trade comparable with the child's potential.
Plus, our primary concern is what happens after he gets out of school. And here, we hope very much that the bill before the Missouri legislature now to provide sheltered workshops will give us some opportunity for him to have a place to go after he does finish school.
So what are we doing? We went to Jefferson City and asked Governor Warren J. Hearns just what was the potential help available for the mentally retarded.
During my administration, I would like to see Missouri abandon its role of laggard in its program for treating the mentally retarded. Toward this end, in my legislative message, I recommended the establishment and support of 9 regional diagnostic and treatment clinics for the mentally retarded. These clinics to supplement the 2 already in operation at Marshall and St. Louis. At the same time, I urge that more attention be given to the salaries of the personnel already serving in our state hospitals and clinics. The same, of course, would apply to the new clinics that I've recommended. I hope the bill can be written into the law with an emergency clause. And if so, these clinics could well be in operation by the early part of the next year. You see, with some 133,000 Missourians affected by varying degrees of mental retardation in our present institutions crowded to capacity, the need for these clinics is urgent.
Governor Hearns has been successful in having his legislation passed, and it does mean there will be 9 more guidance clinics and diagnostic centers. However, there's still a crying need for more protected workshops, for more training centers. The retarded must be trained, not only to benefit society, but for their own dignity. There is satisfaction in any job well done. We have proof of it here.
What you see in this picture illustrates our point of view that there is ability in every human being that just waits to be discovered and developed. We feel strongly that it is essential for an individual to develop a feeling of accomplishment, to add to his pride and prestige, to add to his status as a person. To become self-supporting is one of the goals of many of our so-called students or patients. All of them become acquainted with the world around them. become reality-oriented and no longer live on an island of isolation.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He has the whole world in his hands. He has the whole world in his hands.
Julie?